All right, so welcome everyone. We here, I'm joined by a great brother of mine, mashallah, Abbas. How are you, Abbas?
Alhamdulillah, barakallah feek. All good. How are you doing, akhi?
Alhamdulillah, barakallah feek. So today, I have the honor of bringing you guys a student, mashallah, of Jami'a Ibn Saud, no?
Yeah, Ibn Saud.
Okay, so... So you guys know how it goes. How I learned Arabic stories. This is like the name of the interviews or the series of the interviews that we're doing. In case you didn't know, Abbas. You guys know how it goes. I ask people who went from not knowing Arabic to knowing Arabic about their how it was before, how it was throughout learning, and how it is right now, inshallah. So, first of all, I will ask you, Abbas, inshallah, if you can, give us some background, some context about yourself, what you do, what you did, who are you?
Okay. Bismillah, salatu salam ala Rasulullah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa mawla. Praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and peace and blessings upon our messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm blessed to be with my brother, Mamadou. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and reward you for all your efforts. It's a pleasure to be in your company today. Basically, my name is Abbas Khalif. I'm 25 years old. Student at Imam Muhammad bin Saud in Riyad, alhamdulillah. Been there for the past 4 years. Started the program is the first 3 years we study Arabic, the Arabic Ma'had, which is institute. And after that, the next 4 years, you go to the faculty, which is faculty of Sharia, Hadith, and you choose, and so on. So alhamdulillah, been there past 4 years, finished the Ma'ad. Now the first year of my studies in the faculty. From London, alhamdulillah, just that's a bit by my background.
No, barakallah fik. So, okay, so going straight into the questions. Before learning Arabic, but after you decided that you wanted to learn Arabic, what kept you up at night, like eyes open, staring at the ceiling?
Well, alhamdulillah, since I was young, I used to go to madrasas, which is to learn the Quran and the religion from young age. Alhamdulillah, my parents pushed me to that, encouraged me to that.
In London, right?
From young. So alhamdulillah, I used to go to, there were some Medina graduates, about two of them, and one sheikh that graduated from Riyadh as well. So they had an institute where they used to teach us Islamic studies, Quran, and Arabic. So I see them, I used to think, wow, like they learned the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how they studied it, and how they were teaching the youngsters. And we were young, I was about 13, 14 that age, that time. I think I would love to be like these shuyukh here, and how they had the knowledge they had about the religion, especially Quran. And when I was young, alhamdulillah, since I was younger, I had a passion for Quran. So I used to think to myself, wow, Allah is telling us some stuff, but I don't know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, but I feel the energy, I feel like the beauty of the words. I'm thinking, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran in Arabic, so if I don't learn Arabic, I'm not going to understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to tell me to say. So that's what really pushed me when it comes, especially like the love of the Quran kept me to learn Arabic. So that was the main thing that kept me up at night.
No,
I want Arabic because to learn the Quran and the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
No, that's something that I really, I am always impressed about the Somali community, you know. They could be as ammi as you want, but the Quran is always the Quran.
Yeah,
their kids always go into madrasas and they always memorize the Quran, mashallah.
Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on us all.
No. So learning, right, when you got to, since you already mentioned it, you learn Arabic in the Ma'had of the Jamia. Yes. So when you reached there and, you know, you was about to start learning Arabic, because you didn't learn Arabic in the madrasa when you was younger, right?
No, I didn't, no.
Okay, so what was you afraid of? Like the main things that was making you afraid of, you know, your journey in the Arabic language?
The main thing that got me, I was kind of afraid is, You know, when you learn a new language, the first thing that comes to your head is, if I say this, are people going to laugh at me? If that happens, are people going to mock me? So that's the main thing that I had. But at the same time, I was thinking, for me to learn, I have to make mistakes. Anything in life is like that. If you want to do something, you have to fall into mistakes. Then you're going to learn from it. So I thought, same time, that I was scared of that. If I say this, and because I went to Saudi Arabia, and I was thinking, if I go to the shop and say a word, they might start laughing at me. They might think, this guy's Shakespeare era. Try to speak first-hand stuff. So that was the main thing. And also, that's the main thing. Yeah. Just being scared of falling into mistakes. And it's a human thing. So
Yeah, definitely. That's funny because in Egypt, I mean, it sounds like this to them. It sounds like the Shakespeare of he's trying to brag or something of your Arabic or something. He's like, no, that's all I know. You know what I mean? And it's funny, man, because it keeps happening. Like even right now that I just got here to Mauritania, I feel like I remember when I was looking for an apartment, I went into a real estate agency. And obviously here they all sit on the ground, right? So it was a bunch of people. I stepped in, said, Assalamu alaikum. So, you know, I started speaking, Assalamu alaikum, ana abhath an shaqqa huna fil mantiqa. Everyone's looking at me like, the heck is he talking about? What are you talking about? And in Egypt, it's even funnier because Egyptians are known to be, you know, like even when you go to Mecca, like they are the loudest of the people. And they always, you know, they're always funny. Even in the Arab culture, they always have the most TV shows and the comedy shows and stuff. And so I was in Egypt. This actually happened. I went into a taxi, first of all. I have two stories. The first one, I was in a taxi and I asked him to turn off the music. So I said, Assalamu alaikum ya shaykh, barakallah fik, hal yumkinukum an tughatti shuf al-sawt shuya hakadha. And he was like, يا عم كلمني عربي ما فهمك يعني كلمني عربي ما but in the like in the عمية مصرية, you know.
Yeah.
And even the way I said it right now, it was kind of like, you know, kind of like عمي. And he was like, كلمني عربي أنا ما فهمك يعني. And then another time, I went into a store like a بقالة, as they say in Saudi as well. And I enter and I ask for salt. I say, Assalamu alaikum, هل عندكم من الملح هنا? He says, Sadaq Allah al-Azim ya Shaykh, عايز ايه طيب? He says, Sadaq Allah al-Azim, which is what they say after you finish reciting the Quran. And then they say, طيب, what do you want? I say, الملح, هل عندك ملح, ملح? So, no, inshallah, تعال. So, you know, like classical Arabic is always a quote unquote funny nowadays, you know?
Yeah, it is.
So, okay, so what were you, not knowing Arabic, what were you angry about and who were you angry at, if there was anyone that you was angry at?
Angry at myself for actually not putting emphasis when I was young to actually learn Arabic. That's the main thing. I can't blame no one else but myself. And the second thing is, the first thing who was angry at, and what was the second question? What was the question again? Second one.
What was you angry about? Like something that kept happening, and because you didn't learn Arabic, that made you frustrated.
Something that kept on happening was I kept to read the Quran and I was understanding what I was saying. Yeah. What I was reading.
That's what everyone says. Yeah.
Yeah, that's one thing. Yeah. And especially listen to like scholars and shuyukh and not knowing what they're saying as well. So even someone that used to come to London, and they used to be translators. I was thinking, I wish I understand what the sheikh was saying directly instead of someone being in between us. So that was the thing I was really, really upset with that, especially. Yeah.
That's one. I mean, that's the main two. Mainly in the West, when scholars come and you just have to wait until he finish explaining whatever page of the book for the translator to do his best, really, to try and make you understand what he said. So you already answered this question. I was about to ask you what secretly you desired the most of learning Arabic. And you said kind of like you was looking up to these students of knowledge who came back from overseas.
Yeah.
So let me go into the next one. What was the turning point, or you know, whatever happened that made you say, okay, now I really need to learn Arabic? Or was it just, the university?
I was close to Shiuch, so I was thinking, I talked to him about Medina and the stories they had, stories about Medina. Mm-hmm. And I said, we had the stories, you used to tell me about Medina and listen to this Shiuch, we see that scholar. I knew the scholar's names, but I was thinking, I've never seen him before. And like, oh, subhanAllah, I have to go. Like, they had the big ta'thir on me, especially when he was going to seek knowledge in general, especially the language Arabic. So they had a big effect on me. And a couple of friends that I knew left from London that I went to go study in Medina as well, they had a big effect on me as well. So the two.
So it was kind of gradually kind of thing.
Yeah, it's a gradual thing. Yeah, yeah. Mm. Especially the stories of Medina, they really actually were really, really like pushed me to go seeking knowledge in Arabic. Yeah.
Definitely. Okay, so what was the time frame in between you deciding that you want to study until you actually, you know, got the opportunity to go to Riyadh?
Time frame was maybe about 1 year or 2 years. On YouTube and about shuyukh and scholars and a lot of lessons that you see online and them coming down to London. That, from me seeking knowledge, I thought, that's it, I have to leave, I have to go see. Apply for Jama'ah to go. I have to get accepted. I have to find a way out. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me with the opportunity, and it's the best thing I've ever done in my life. So looking back now, thinking, wow, that's the best opportunity. Alhamdulillah, Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make me from those that are grateful, man. So, best thing ever.
Tayyib, so what was the method you guys used in the Jamia, in the bachelor's? Or, I mean, in the Ma'had?
When it comes to, in general, Arabic, I realized my personal experience, I don't know, maybe you can relate to it, is it depends on the teacher you have.
Mm-hmm.
And if the teacher makes everything easy, you understand it. Yeah. If the teacher makes everything difficult, that's going to be hard.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen some brothers that when they hear Arabic, oh, Arabic, can't stand it. It's too much. And then you tend to realize if you ask them, it goes back to the way the teacher went through. Because what we went through is in the Ma'had, in the Institute in Riyadh, in Arabic faculty, was it depends. The teacher, some teachers will come to you, and when they're teaching the subject, they understand it completely. Even grammar, you know how grammar is in Arabic is really, it's difficult.
Yeah.
You get a teacher, you make you understand everything. Thinking, oh, this is the grammar they used to screw about. Dislike that subject. And then the semester after, you have another teacher, makes everything difficult. You thinking, forget this, I'm giving up.
Mm-hmm.
But the method that we used to have was, especially one teacher I really, really, really liked when we teach Arabic from the get-go in the Ma'had, was his method was, I'm not going to teach you no grammar. We're going to take words. Every day we're going to take words and we're going to put it into sentence. And then we're going to start having conversations with the same words, using them words. So that's the best method I've seen for myself personally, and the people in my class that I benefit from. Mm-hmm. And at the end, when you finish all that, and we used to go which is the Ma'ad was 4 levels. So the first 2 levels, if it depends, every time they used to change teachers. So when I used to have that teacher, he used to put in groups, we speak, have conversations using the same words that we learned. Then after that, gradually, he will teach us grammar. Grammar will come at the end.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the best method that I've seen personally, and I've seen a lot of people when it comes to teaching Arabic. A lot of people I've seen, in the West especially, when it comes to Arabic, they start with grammar, which is I disagree with completely.
Yeah, meaning, completely. Yeah.
You should start the person, start with words. As in English, for example, when you're teaching a person English, you don't start with grammar straight away, do you? No. Gradually, words, use them words in sentence, day by day. Then you see them gradually learning. And then after that, you can hit them with the grammar.
Yeah. But, definitely. I completely agree with you because I mean, that's, as you know, I have an online program, Arabic online program, and that's what we focus on. We focus on learning the language, not learning, you know, aspects out of the language to understand the language, which is like, for example, grammar, morphology and stuff like that. So, and I know for a fact that this is how you learn a language because I've learned French out of, you know, not being native at it. I've learned English, like right now I'm speaking in English. I have learned English and I know what was the process of it. I didn't go into, I mean, even right now, if you ask me, to be honest, I couldn't even tell you nothing about grammar or anything like that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? In terms of like in the Arabic language, I mean, in the English language. So it's definitely learning vocabulary and learning how to communicate. And this is what I tell my students, because at the end of the day, you know, if you learn Arabic for your deen, you want to learn, you want to be able to read the books, you want to be able to go to the sheikh and ask him, what does this mean? And be able to understand the explanation in Arabic, what he's trying to explain to you in Arabic. And most of the times that doesn't have nothing to do with you knowing, you know, if you say, Kana Muhammadun Aliman, it doesn't have nothing to do with you knowing if this is mansub or if it's marfu, yani. You know what I mean? Yeah. So sure. Definitely agree with you, man. So for how long did you study? Well, how long was the program for Arabic?
It's 3 years, but when the four levels just take 2 years. Mm-hmm. So there's another something called diploma, which is after, just extra. But the main whole faculty, whole institute was 2 years. Mm-hmm.
So you didn't take the extra diploma?
No, I didn't take it, no.
Mm-hmm. So what was your feelings throughout, like, you know, when you, like, the first, in throughout those three years, what was the feelings like?
Feelings were, it was mixed emotions.
Yeah.
Feel like sometimes I want to give up. That's it. I'm going to throw the books away. That's it. I'm done.
Yeah.
Sometimes happy. Sometimes it was stress. So it's so stressful, especially exam season. Mm-hmm. So it was mixed feelings. I can't say what is 24/7 good and 24/7 bad, but it's seeking knowledge in general for you. Like you mentioned before, the main thing for us to seek knowledge, learn Arabic is not just because it's for the sake of it. It's the main thing is to learn our religion. That's it.
Yeah.
A lot of people think when it comes to Arabic, it's only for Arabs. No, for you to learn your religion and grow gradually and learn from the scholars and sit down with them. And like you mentioned, go straight to them instead of going through translators. You have to learn Arabic. You can't be, for you not to learn Arabic, you're being a stranger in your religion, basically. Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
That's the main Quran, Arabic. Everything, our messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his words, Arabic.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Arabic. So you have to go. Yeah.
Definitely.
Reading English books for the rest of their lives. So,
Okay. While learning the Arabic language, do you have aha moments? And I don't know if you guys understand this term in the UK, like aha moments.
What's that? Aha.
You know, like you'd be like, oh, aha, like this. Like for example, a aha moment for me was like when we were starting. And we learned, you know, the al-madi, al-mudari', wal-amr. And I always keep, what is al-amr? How do you even use al-amr? And then I understood the al-amr, how to use it. And then I was praying once and I said, Rabbi, ighfirli. And I was, oh, ighfirli comes from ghafira yaghfiru. And then I was, oh, you know what I mean? Now it makes sense. Everything makes sense. Like I have been saying "Ighfirli, Rabbi Ighfirli" all my life, you know, since I started practicing. But I never knew what it was until I actually learned Arabic and I learned, you know, the tense of the amr and all of this stuff. So, do you have any kind of moment where you was like, "Oh, okay, this meant this. Okay, this meant that."
There were, but that's the. A question I need to think about the answer for that. There was, but literally, it's not in my head now. But yeah. Inshallah. When I think about sorry about that.
Khair, inshallah. So, what was the daily books that you always had with you while learning the Arabic language?
Daily books. daily books. In Arabic or English? Arabic, yeah?
Yeah, whatever. If it was in English, if it was in Arabic. But, you know, for example, for us, it was, I mean, for me, at least, I always had the al-wasit, the dictionary, the Arabic to Arabic dictionary, the tasrifat dictionary, and the mutaradifat wal-addad dictionary, and my kitab al-tabyid, which is where I had all my words and verbs that I did memorize already. That's why I couldn't go anywhere without those books in my back, in my bag.
The main books I used to have was translations of the Quran, number one. Mm-hmm. Always. Bukhari in English as well, translated in Arabic, both sides, one page, Arabic only. And which is and the Ma'had books I used to have, like the institute books. That's the main books I used to have all the time. The time, especially the writing book as well, I used to have pencil. So I'd write down anything I used to, like, for example, any words I use today, write it down. And so, yeah, that's the main books I used to have,
طيب. So if you were to rate your conversational skills from 1 to 10 without being humble, what would you say?
Arabic is the language. If you don't speak, like, using Arabic, you're going to forget a lot of stuff. Yeah. You don't listen. I would say 8.
Okay. So, I mean, with you, I feel confident that we can... يعني ممكن نستطيع أن نري الناس كيف أنا أتكلم بالعربية.
والله لا بأس إن شاء الله.
طيب. فإن شاء الله أسألك سؤال واحد بالعربية وتجيب عليه إن شاء الله. So, طيب. فما نوع الفصل الذي كنت تفضل؟ هل كان جماعي ولا أو جماعي أو خاص؟ وطبعا أظن أنكم ما كنتم تدرسون خاص.
لا ما كنا ندرس خاص، كنا يعني خلال يعني 20 طالب تقريبا كنا في الفصل. أنا أفضل خاص.
نعم.
بعض الأحيان وبعض الأحيان عام. مثال إذا لدينا اختبار يعني أراجع نفسي ثم أذهب مع إلى أصدقائي ونراجع معا.
نعم.
فهذه الطريقة هاي يعني أفضل الخاص.
نعم.
من عموما.
نعم. طيب خير إن شاء الله. خير إن شاء الله. طيب بن. What do you think is the hardest part of learning Arabic?
The hardest part? It has to be grammar.
Yeah. إعراب. إعراب is like math.
Yeah, that's the hardest part, I would say. But like I mentioned before, just when you're starting, especially as a new student, don't busy yourself with that.
Yeah.
Know it, don't go too deep. After when you gradually pick it up, then you can go in deep into it. So it has to be grammar, definitely.
Grammar, man. Amr wa Zaid wa. Okay, so how of an impact has had learning the Arabic language and knowing it in your life? And how is it different now?
Big impact. Alhamdulillah, now I can just go to the rest of the scholars and just benefit. Gradually had a big effect, especially the Quran as well. Now, reading the tafsir, different translations of the Quran in Arabic. Alhamdulillah, that made a big effect in my life, especially the month of Ramadan and the month of the Quran.
No.
Listen to lectures. It played a massive role. Massive.
No.
I was. Well, that's one that what actually wants to go learn Arabic, start now. You know, one thing in general, just don't leave. So far, just do it now.
No,
so if you want to learn Arabic, I'll definitely start today.
Yeah. Okay. So that's actually the last question is, what would you advise for the person that knows and acknowledges the importance of learning Arabic and he wants to learn but doesn't know, you know, where to start, or just a general advice for anyone who is willing or wanting to learn the Arabic language?
General advice is first, make your intentions clear for the sake of Allah.
Mm-hmm.
That you want to learn Arabic so you can uplift the ignorance from yourself and to learn the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Mm-hmm.
And learn the way of Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I will say, you know, a lot of people when it comes to you, learn Arabic. Some people can leave the country and go abroad, Egypt, Saudi, but some people can't. So those that can't, don't act like, that's it, I can't do nothing. Like I mentioned, the course you're doing, I would definitely advise that. You're a truthful person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. And I would definitely advise to find courses online. Like you just mentioned, convenient. You can stay at home. You can gradually learn one-to-one with you as well. I'll definitely learn. The internet these days, you can learn a lot of stuff.
I know.
Internet, there's khair and there's shar, there's bad and there's good.
Mm-hmm.
We always hear the bad side, but there's so much good on the internet. You can learn like from durus. Even now, even some scholars they used to believe that going online and is haram, videos are haram. Now they see big effect it has on people, and then that said it, they turn the fatwa back. So definitely, because they know that the thing that online could do has a big effect. So I would definitely recommend to find online courses that are convenient for you, for your time, and because a lot of people might be working. And it's hard for you to go seek knowledge. And some people, even some brothers I know personally, they would love to seek knowledge, but they have to look after their parents, family, they're the oldest. So I would say recommend your course 100%, 110%.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's definitely. I mean, technology right now, man, it's crazy, man. I mean, for myself, and I will be honest, when I started practicing, it was only because of, you remember Roadside to Islam?
Yeah, it was at
the video. I mean, the stories that used for me coming from Spain, where there is, I mean, we don't have communities like you guys have in the UK or you know in France, in the US, in Spain. Literally, I still don't know a brother. I still don't know a brother in Spain that he can relate to me in terms of you know talab al-ilm or scholars or whatever it may be. It's super rare. You know what I mean? So technology, I mean, social media and stuff like this, definitely, you know, and this is something that I was about to ask you as well. If you see yourself maybe in the near future teaching online or, you know, benefiting people or.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Definitely. That's the one of the main things I want to do, just. Why not, man? Why not? But as Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the person when he leaves things, sadaqun jariya, like a consistent charity that's going to last for long, is beneficial knowledge, man. So I definitely would love to teach on Arabic online. So in the near future, 100%, inshallah.
No, inshallah. So would you like to let people know where to find you if they would like to contact you or for whatever?
Yeah, on Instagram, Abbas Khalif, AWBAS dot okay. Khalif.
We're going to have that, inshallah, in the description.
Inshallah, barakallahu feek. Yeah, on Instagram, email, so yeah. Mainly Instagram, I'm on there. So yeah,
okay. Find me there. Okay, inshallah. So, I mean, we done with this interview. Man, it was a blessing having you, an honor having you today in here.
Likewise, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and bless all everything, all the good work you're doing. Keep it up. We support you. Jazakallah khair.
Ameen. Barakallah feek. So guys, for all the viewers, thank you for tuning in. Thank you for watching. Again, if you guys would like to give us feedback or something that you didn't like or suggestion, whatever you may be, leave it in the comments below and tell us what do you think about learning Arabic and the journey. And if you would like to as well, jump in and you know, jump on an interview. Just leave it in the comments. Contact me, get in touch, inshallah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullah.